What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another live Engadget Podcast broadcast. I'm senior editor Devendra Hardwar. Today, I'm joined by our reviews editor, Sherlyn Lowe. Hey, Sherlyn.
Hello, hello.
Hello. And our podcast producer, Ben Ellman.
Hello.
Covered in, shadow almost. Like, I love the effect. I love the effect
going on there, Ben. It's just coming through the slats.
Very mysterious. Yeah. And today, folks, I think pretty much all these weeks throughout fall, we're just going to be talking about the major hardware events and things are going to be happening. So it's going to be, we're going to be diving into everything we learned from Amazon's event, which is probably the most boring of the ones we've seen. But hey, there's gear to talk about. Sherlyn will fill us all in on some Google stuff. And we'll be talking about the Facebook slide releases too, about their research into mental health. So yeah, we're going to kick off the show soon. Want to say good morning to everybody in the podcast chat. In the live stream chat, hello, Chiming Chung.
Yes, Chiming Chung.
Louis Knott Jr., hello.
Yes.
Thank you for joining us, everybody.
Let me see.
Everyone, I think the unofficial Sherlyn fan club just appears every week, so it's great.
That's not true. We're just Dan Gadget fans. I think that's what they're,
Are you excited about any of this Amazon stuff, Sherlyn?
I have thoughts.
Yep.
What am I excited for? I guess I kind of like the robot. Jonathan Tran and Vinny Kusaki. Good morning.
Good morning. Let's load up your questions, folks. So yeah, if you've got questions about the Amazon stuff or whatever, as usual, we'll be recording the podcast and we'll do some Q&A in between segments. So you can chat with us.
Wilso is here. Francis Thomas says hi from Shanghai. Hello. Yes. What Dev said.
What? Yeah. What's what happening?
Yes. What you said about the recording.
But we're going to be doing, I think, leading with the Amazon robot, which is kind of the weirdest thing, but also I think the, I don't know. We'll talk about it. Maybe less interesting than it appears at first. But thank you all for joining us. We have thoughts. Cool. Are we ready to kick off the podcast?
Yeah, I think we are. Maybe let's see if we can get some of Chiming Chung's questions in, which is just that there's still no Chinese support for Alexa, which seems kind of strange.
That's going to be hard for Amazon, but that is that's a whole other ball. It's a big topic, right?
Yeah, we can bring it up.
I don't know if you've looked into any of that stuff, Sherlyn, and like voice assistant support within China, but the way Amazon does it, I feel like would be hard.
I'm not sure how Amazon specifically does it, but as a pioneer in voice assistants, they should be really, honestly, early, like better.
Yeah, we'll talk about this because I think Alexa's big.
Exactly.
Their big thing was just like they just focused on English for years, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's like that is why their English voice command stuff was better than a lot of other folks. So,
but then they forgot.
Now
about
you got to go to the rest of the world. Yeah. Okay.
We got you, Chiming Chung.
All right, I think we're good to go. Okay. Let's kick off in 3, 2, 1. What's up, internet, and welcome back to the Engadget Podcast. I'm senior editor Devendra Hardwar.
I'm reviews editor Sherlyn Lowe.
This week, it's all about Amazon, specifically that Amazon robot, which I don't know if I should trust or destroy. I don't know if you've got any further thoughts on that, Sherlyn, like immediate thoughts, one sentence slot on the robot.
Kind of cute, but not very.
But not very. And it has a camera and it patrols your home. As always, folks, if you're enjoying the Engadget Podcast, please be sure to subscribe to us on iTunes or your podcatcher of choice. Leave us a review on iTunes. That's always super helpful. And drop us an email. We're at podcast@engadget.com. We also typically do a live stream of our, you know, of the episodes Thursdays around 10 a.m. Eastern. You can find us on the Engadget YouTube channel. And, you can chat with us live. You can ask us some questions. It's a pretty fun time. Let's talk about this Amazon event, though, Sherlyn, because it is funny how, like, every year Amazon kind of follows what Apple does and kind of what Google does, and even after Microsoft's events. And Amazon's is, like, the least organic of them all, like, in terms of hosting and the products. The executive they brought out this year, I forget if he was in there in previous years, But he gives me very strong Forrest McNeil energy Comedy Central's review. Pretty much the same look too. So I had a hard time taking him seriously. And at the end of the day, it's like it's stuff you would expect from Amazon, right? And you had a great piece where basically the big thing Amazon does is just make the stuff other people are doing, copy other people, and do it cheaper. You know, like that is the overall broad theme.
Yep.
Go check out that piece from Sherlyn. We'll dive into some of that. And then there are the like outlier things Amazon does, like the big long shot stuff. And I think the biggest one this year is the robot, the Astro robot, which is a home security, home companion robot. It has cameras. It can move around your home. It does all this weird stuff, too, because it's like, first of all, it's kind of cute. Looks like an 80s robot. Has a screen, it has eyes and a face. And this is the exact danger of any robot like this, by the way, because it's like, oh, it's cute. So it's so cute. You don't realize like when, you know, if you go to somebody's home and they have one of these roaming around, you don't realize like your rights are being kind of like stripped away, because these things are you could put them in a mode where it follows new people in your house. It will like collect information about them, and like if they do anything weird, it'll alert you. It's like a little dog that'll also like just spy on new people in your home.
I missed this part of the announcement. I think I was writing up my other pose, and I completely missed this part. And I see why now. It's completely creepy. I'm sorry.
It's just a camera on wheels. Yeah, it's super creepy. And that's the thing. Like, what else does it do other than be cute and be a camera? It has a like this telescopic rod that kind of extends up and gives you like a camera view higher up too. So if like you don't know if you left your stove on or something, you could like pop up and see the knobs or the actual burners. But at the end of the day, it is just like it is a moving camera on wheels that can patrol your home and spy on people in your home. It just looks cute. It doesn't have much of a purpose right now.
Yeah, I'll say that like there's been devices that do this. There's a lot of robots that can follow you around. I've seen some demoed. Timmy, the personal robot, at least 3 years ago, also had Alexa built in. It was taller. It definitely did follow me around the demo.
Has it been
area.
Released? Is this thing like I've seen
$1,000? It's more than actually it's $1,000 to $2,000, right? I mean, to be fair, Amazon's not yet releasing its thing either. I'm just saying the concept isn't new, but what Amazon is doing here with what you're saying, if it's really monitoring people's behavior and then flagging when something seems out of the ordinary, that is definitely something I've seen done before, and
it's kind of funny. And I think like maybe for home security, it could be kind of good. Or at least for people who are really, really like paranoid about what's going on in their homes, like it could patrol your home. If it sees somebody, if it sees something, it can alert you. It ties into, I believe, the Ring, the new like Ring Protect plans and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, it is just a moving camera. You can attach like this. You can attach a cup holder to the back of it. So
I mean, that's the only thing I would use this for. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like snack. This is my snack machine. Mm-hmm. That's it. Astro,
they'll just follow you around the
popcorn.
House.
Right. And then constantly have like, Astro, bring me dim sum. And then like if it were a built-in microwave or something, like in its little chest cavity, be like, popping your popcorn. Oh no, cuter voice, popping your popping your popcorn now, and then bringing it to you.
You just want to go straight into the like Wall-E future where you're just like laying down all the time and things get delivered to you. I'm sure we're gonna get there. That is where our robots are going to take us eventually. But this guy is not that. It is just wheels and a camera, and it follows you around. It has kind of a cute display. I'm not a huge fan. And there was actually some fun reporting from Vice, and I believe mainly Vice, where people who used to work on this thing from Amazon were like, this thing is a disaster. It will throw itself downstairs, you know, like willy-nilly. Like, it doesn't really have good safety mechanisms. It breaks all the time. That telescopic camera is really, like, fragile. So a lot of people are saying this thing isn't ready for release. But
well, so yeah. Ryan Watson in our chat said that they would have bought it if Amazon had made it a vacuum. And I was thinking the exact same thing. Mm-hmm. Like I wouldn't mind a robot in the house, but I wanted to do more than just like follow me around, look at things. If it were a robot vacuum that had all these extra built-in features, mm-hmm. Hell yeah. Get that thing. Yeah.
I was honestly surprised. Like, I was expecting iRobot, the mm-hmm. Roomba company, to do something like this first, because they have put robots in people's homes for 20 years now, right. Like for 2 decades, and mainly because they're cute little vacuums. They're frustrating.
They don't poop anymore. Yeah.
Yeah. They don't. Well, that's what they say, or they'll replace it. But I could eventually see a Roomba with a screen on it or something that was a little more smart and could patrol mm-hmm. and do other things. Exactly. And I'm sure they will get there. It's just like, sometimes Amazon takes those leaps where they jump ahead of everybody else. And even they don't, like, it's a clear moonshot. They don't know if it's going to pay off. I think the original Kindle was pretty much like that too. That's one of those things, like the myth around Jeff Bezos is that he makes some of these, and some of those things fail, like the Fire mm-hmm. Phone. And some of them, like the Kindle, which sort of like transformed the way we expected to read, because e-readers existed before, but the centralized platform to buy books and everything wasn't a thing. And even then, Kindles aren't like, they're not like iPads, right? Not everybody has them. They're not the biggest thing in the world anymore. But it was big enough to make Amazon like pretty important at that time. Mm-hmm. He also had like the idea to do, hey, people need server stuff. Let's just build big server farms so AWS, people can do cloud stuff. And AWS became like a huge, huge hit too. And nobody expected that from a company that sold books online, you know? So they occasionally make these shots. I don't know. This thing is going to be, I think it's up for pre-order for $1,000. Eventually it's going to be jumping up to $1,450. It's essentially a beta. You're paying this money mm-hmm. to be a beta tester for this thing. I would warn people that this seems like a very, very bad idea. You know, like you don't pay to be a beta tester. They should be handing these things out for people to test. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean that's been the way Amazon's done a lot of its releases for a while, right? Like with the original Echo, I think it was invite only for the longest time.
For Prime subscribers,
And then the new things that they always roll out, like the Amazon frames, the Echo frames, took a while to become non-invite only. The mm-hmm. Halo band was invite only. The Echo look was invite only. Speaking of things that were invite only, the Amazon Ring, I forget what the name is, but they had made a ring and it just never got released. It was so-called invite only. It still hasn't been
released. They announced the ring, yeah.
Yeah, and so this could be one of those things where it's been announced and then it just never comes to market. Mm-hmm. Or we have to wait forever for them to figure out how to make it stop throwing itself down the stairs.
How to stop that.
That was so funny.
They did bring back the home security drone was something they announced. Yeah. I think last year we were like,
yep.
I don't know if this is ever going to exist. I don't know if they're ever actually going to release
it's
it.
Kind
but
of cool, yeah.
It's, I mean, again, it's one of those things where it's like, okay, they say soon, maybe you'll be able to test it soon. We don't quite know enough about it. And I have the same reservations about that as I do the robot. You know, like unless you're a scientist who has like really, or, you know, a government official who has confidential data, highly classified data in their homes, the idea of having like a sentry drone seems overkill for most people. Yeah. But I guess we'll see. It just it sounds horrifying to me. Mm-hmm. You were really interested in something that they announced, though, Sherlyn, which is basically just a bigger Echo Show. Like all they put, they made a bigger Echo Show. It has a 15-inch screen. That's it.
It looks good though. You know what I mean? Like I'm in the market for art. I've been shopping for the longest time for art, and I don't like art that's not personal. Even though the aesthetic is really nice, this is the sort of frame that I like. Right, the little like black border with the white mat and the screen in the middle.
The most basic of frames, by the way.
Very basic frame.
Yeah.
I'm basic as it comes. Like, I don't like the gold embossed, like carved out sort of style. It's too much for me. I like this basic look. But I just thought it was funny because that was when I first started thinking Amazon's ripping everyone off, aren't they? Because the interface that they introduced with the Echo Show 15 too, I was just like, that is Google's smart display interface. That's exactly it. Excuse mm-hmm. me. But no, I mean, the smart display looks good with the new software. Well, the updated software, you can do things like leave notes for your family members. You can see your upcoming events. You can see the weather. You can watch videos. So, I mean, it's useful. Mm-hmm. And I, you know what? We like mock it, but I can tell you that there's going to be a lot of people who live in like big households that will find it useful, and they might just buy it because like it's one spot on the wall where like everyone can go to look at like their upcoming chores or like reminders. I don't know. I mean, hopefully Google makes a better version of it, but then
there, you know. Yeah, I don't know if you need a display for that. Like typically those things, it's like for a big family, right? It is a calendar on the wall. It has a lot of notes on it scribbled on, and it's like a big, highly interactive thing. I don't know if a single smart display can kind of replace that for people, but hey, it could be cool. This was inevitable because basically first came the Echo, then came the Echoes with screens, and they just got bigger and bigger and bigger. And you can't have a 15-inch screen just sitting on your kitchen countertop. So they had to make it something like this that you hang on the wall and is basically a kitchen TV and sort of like a feature display that you'd expect to see on like Back to the Future or something, right? Like from a sci-fi movie. It's a cool idea, but again, like I don't trust Amazon enough for this stuff. And here's the thing, I have Echo devices. I have Alexa devices in my home. I use Echo quite a bit. I use the Alexa voice assistant quite often. It's just they make these leaps into things where I don't fully buy into everything. And we don't have to. You can pick and choose what you need from all these companies. But you're down with this, Sherlyn. I'm glad about that. It's only $250 too, so it's not that expensive.
I'm not getting it for myself for the one very simple reason. It's wall mounted. I don't do wall mounting anything, so it just looks nice. Great.
It looks very nice. It's fine. They also unveiled a new fitness band, which I'm sure you're very excited about. It's your favorite thing in the world.
I was like, this is what I had to write up for the event, and I was like, what wearable could they announce? The Bloomberg report before the event was like, oh, they have some sort of kid-centric wearable or for seniors. I was like, okay, nope, it's a new Halo. Our favorite Amazon wearable, the Halo, which was originally a fitness band that had no screen, that had microphones on board to detect your voice and tell you, hey,
it was
chill out.
The tone policing band. Yeah,
the feature was even called tone. What happened was Amazon just said it took Halo and added a screen to it, but it didn't tell you during the event that it took away the microphones. It does not have microphones on this thing, the thing called Halo View. So with the screen, you can view it, haha. And it will do some pretty basic things. It'll do like steps tracking, heart rate monitoring, and with heart rate, it can do your blood oxygen. You can get some text notifications. Here's my thing. I don't know how much like I can say about this, but Amazon will, I guess, say that it does a lot of things, but it doesn't do that many things, especially when you compare it to what this thing looks the most like, which is the Fitbit Charge 5. If you look at the Fitbit Charge 5, it's the exact same aesthetic. I'm sorry. It's like a rectangular screen on a strap, which, to be fair, is most fitness trackers. You can't put a screen on a strap in many different ways. But this, even down to the OS, looks like they ripped the freak off of Fitbit OS. I'm sorry. Like, I can't.
And this is what Amazon does. This is their thing. Yeah.
And this thing's going to cost like $80, and then you have to pay like $4 a month for the Halo subscription to use some of the other features in the app. Like tone is part of it, body composition, sleep insight, sleep score, that sort of thing, all are locked under that $4 a month fee, which is very similar to what Fitbit does on its Charge and other devices. But Fitbit Charge costs like more. I think I can't remember the offhand what the Fitbit Charge goes for, the Charge 5. But more than $100. And then the Fitbit premium subscription starts at $10 a month. So what Amazon has done here is basically like, hey, you like the Fitbit Charge 5? You like the exact look, the exact OS, but you don't want to pay like $100 and then $10 a month for it? Here, take ours. Ours is like $4 a month and then like just $70, $80.
It's just funny to see Amazon keep doing this, like essentially release copycat products, which, hey, a lot of the tech industry does this too. But we've talked about this before where Amazon is in like a very unique position, right? Like they have the data, of stuff mm-hmm. people are buying, and even the stuff people aren't buying, the stuff people may put in a wish list or save in their cart and like hover around, and they see mm-hmm. like what's potentially popular, and they can be like, okay, if we can make the same device and make it half the price, you know, and essentially do the same thing, we could just scoop up all these users. And Amazon does this over and over again. That's
yeah
part of like the big antitrust argument against them too. They are both a yeah. store and the biggest online store right. and the producer of products, and it gets a little wonky. Your piece, Sherlyn, I think is really good because it gets into the fact that yeah, they just exist to make certain things cheaper. That even is true. They showed off something called the Amazon Glow, which is an interactive kid tablet. It is like a tablet that stands up in portrait mode. You can video chat with your grandparents, but there's also like this thing at the top, which creates a holographic display that's like touch interactive on a table or something. And I've seen this tech before in a couple of things, and there are actually other kids' products already. You had brought up one, yep. Sherlyn.
The Osmo, yeah.
The Osmo, which I know among parents, like, is something a lot of people are interested in. If you go look at Amazon, the Amazon listings for the Osmo, really, really popular, like really high reviews.
Yep.
It is a very popular product. So I wonder, right? You don't have to be like a freaking detective to see like what happens here, where a very popular yep. product eventually gets yep. copied by Amazon. And there's kind of nothing to protect companies from this. But yeah, what is the Glow, real quick?
I mean, it's the Glow. You just described it really well.
Yeah, so, yeah. I mean, it's a thing for kids. It is a way for kids to chat with people, but also play games at the same time.
Yes, right.
Which is, it prevents the thing from like a kid just staring at a screen or not being very engaged with the video chat, which is the problem I have with my daughter sometimes. Aww. Like, I video chat my parents all the time so they can talk with her, but you know, she doesn't want to do that. But if she can play a game remotely with her grandparents or something, like, that could be cool. And if it could be an educational game, even better.
Yeah.
That is the essential idea here. Yeah.
If they could take turns and play the same game, yes. But I kind of saw it as like the person on the call watches on as your kid is playing. I'm like, how engaging is that? But no, if they're taking turns, they're actively playing together. I could see that being interesting. To the point though about what Amazon does, right? It's mm-hmm. I mean, we've seen peak designs go ham on you know, calling out Amazon for ripping off the design of its popular bags and selling them for much cheaper with poorer mm-hmm. materials or you know what the peak design is claiming. There's that, and that's what Amazon seems to be doing here with the Osmo. Actually, sorry, my bad. The Glow. which is very similar to the Osmo. Also very similar to HP's Sprout 3D right. printer type of all-in-one with a similar swivel camera attachment at the top that can see what you're doing on the surface in front of it. But the other thing that reminded me, too, when you were talking about Amazon harvesting data, is that like with the ban, like going backwards a little bit, one of the things that Fitbit always says about its new features is like, people are always like, oh, so how did you come up with this feature? They're always like, with all this insight that we have,
right,
from all
right.
the Fitbits all over the place. So don't tell me that like they're not using your data. But at least with Fitbit, I don't know what else they're doing with your data, but at least with Fitbit, so far what we know is they've taken the data and studied people's habits to come up with like ideas for future innovations, future things that they could do better differently. And that's led them to things like whatever fitness guides they have under the premium plan, whatever ECG, EEG, skin temperature variation. They keep saying that this is more stuff they, you know, people want. And then adding more sensors onto a thing helps them collect more data, whatever. But with the Halo View, like Amazon's collecting similar data, and Amazon doesn't need to be innovating in the health space, not really. Like, they're straight ripping off other people. So what's that data going to be used for? To like tell you, hey, your blood sugar is low, maybe buy some sugar-free donuts?
They can certainly. On Amazon,
you know what I mean?
It's a cross-section of data. Like, Amazon is this big Borg of a company that can do all sorts of stuff and then recommend, hey, watch this fitness show, you know, like do this other stuff, buy this exercise bike while you're binging Amazon Prime Video. They could do anything. It is funny that Microsoft used to get a lot of flack in the 90s for basically scooping up smaller companies, you know, and just kind of absorbing them. At least they bought the companies at least right. they bought their IP. Whereas now you could just be like, a nice thing you got there.
Let me make it.
Let me make it. And I know exactly who's making it for you. It's not that hard for me to go find the same OEMs to build
white label.
It.
Yep.
Yeah. It's all, it's all something. So, hey, let us know what you guys think about the Amazon robot and kind of the way they position their products. I am just highly skeptical at this point.
I just want to point out very quickly, mm-hmm. this is a only slightly related observation, which is that it's funny, like Amazon's naming standards are interesting. Other than their Ring and Blink products, everything mm-hmm. rhymes with O. Echo, Estro, Glow, Halo.
Sure.
Like, oh my gosh.
What does that mean?
The Kindle. I made that work. But there's a couple points that people are bringing up in our live chat too, which, by the way, you can join us, like the Vindra said, on to talk to us. But Ryan Watson also points out that, you know, all of this is just extra waste. It's all plastic ending up in the landfill. Absolutely. And that's mm-hmm. exactly, that's part of the, and like Amazon did kick off its event talking about all the sustainability efforts. And, you know, they came under a lot of criticism for the carbon footprint of all the packages they sent over and over, like, so many times on different days.
It's the only company that has to, like, be, like, slowing down the stuff that's optimized. Like, slow down deliveries and call that a feature and then call that sustainability. It's kind of hilarious, yeah.
Oh, it is really hilarious. Mm-hmm. And then there was you know... They also, by the way, teamed up with Disney and said, like, you can now say, hey, Disney, instead of, you know, Alexa.
Yeah. And in hotel rooms, right? Yeah.
Yeah. You know what's funny, though? It's like, I believe this is the case. And when I was checking out, but I believe that Alexa's, oh, crap. Amazon's the only one that lets you change the wake word for your assistant, which means you could already have said, hey Disney to Alexa.
I don't, can you make it any word? I thought it was like, hey computer is the only thing, but I have not played around with that in a while.
I haven't played around with it too much too, but it looked like it was pretty customizable. I'll have to look into it, but
okay.
I don't think this is like a groundbreaking feature, but talking about Amazon's voice assistant too, another person on the chat, Jimmy Chong, brought up on that like Amazon still doesn't support a lot of languages, right? Mm-hmm. For their voice assistant. And that's something where it's behind, right? Where they actually, in my mind, pioneered this voice assistant technology, at least with smart home products. So why are they so behind when it comes to this?
Does Siri, does like Google's voice stuff, does it work better in China and other countries?
I know that I definitely know mm-hmm. Siri works in uh-huh. Chinese and Cantonese because I had my parents set up their phones to use Siri in Cantonese. Mm-hmm. It was funny as hell. Siri has sass in Cantonese.
Oh boy. Siri is also just not good in English. So, okay.
No, not at all. But mm-hmm. she's just funny in Cantonese. I don't think she works very well, but, you know, mm-hmm. she understands. And then I think Google Assistant is supported in quite a few languages, but I'm not entirely sure if it's like Chinese mm-hmm. and Cantonese just yet. Let me look that up really quick.
Yeah. While we're talking about this, like the key that Amazon had, like when they announced the first Echo and they were working on all this voice tech, everybody else, like Siri actually existed before, Google's voice stuff existed before the Echo.
Yeah.
Everybody else was trying multiple languages. And Amazon was just like, okay, just English. You know, let's just do this and focus on this basically for the US. And they didn't even really release the Echo in other countries for a while. And by doing that, you can build a voice model that's very like specific to one language. That's why they released it in beta testing basically to Prime subscribers. And when Prime people first got those Echoes, it wasn't very good. It wasn't very accurate. Yeah. But like a year later or 6 months later, by the time I wrote a piece about the very first Echo, because they didn't send it out for review, by the time they were sending it out, it was a lot better because all those early users had tested, had trained the voice model. So I don't know.
I remember this,
Yeah. Are they going to do something similar for other languages? I don't even know like necessarily how big Amazon is in China, where you already have like a lot of other e-commerce giants too, right? So it's like maybe they don't even have the same amount of play.
They do, yeah. Mm-hmm. Huawei, I know a lot of little like a lot of the tech companies in China have their own versions. So I think Xiaomi's is Xiaoi, and Huawei's was something else. I can't remember what Huawei's was, but they've all built in their little voice assistants. Alibaba has their own as well. Tmall has the Genie, I think. Man, I'm not super up to speed, but I believe I've heard at least some of these. Updating you guys, by the way, the Google Assistant is available in various Chinese languages, but not the new Google Assistant on specific devices. So like the one that is faster, that does a lot more things, they're still like, I think, rolling that out to other languages or updating. And also depending on what type of device apparently that I use. So we'll see. I tried to add Chinese and they're like, are you sure you want to do this?
Voice is important, and every company is going to be focusing on this. But here's the thing about voice interactions. If you get it wrong once, it's like 100 times more frustrating than if you like click a button and like something goes wrong on your computer. Like it's sort of like trying to explain something to somebody and they just don't get it. And on a personal level, you just like, you get frustrated. You're like, ah.
The number of times I've yelled at my poor speakers that don't deserve it, it's pretty bad.
That's it. So voice interactions kind of have to be a certain level of perfect before they're usable. Can be like the Star Trek computer where you're just like asking something aloud and it gets, you know, answered really quickly. And then sometimes it could just be a nightmare. And that I often encounter the nightmare too many times.
Yeah, I get very frustrated. I will not tell y'all what about, I guess.
All right, we'll be keeping an eye on all these Amazon products. I don't know if I would test the Astro Robot. Maybe just for like educational purposes, I'd bring it in because my daughter's already, she is like a good little soldier for the robot wars. Like she is ready to fight them all. She was terrified of Roombas from the beginning. She's both fascinated by them, but also is like, why is that robot moving? Why is that robot talking? You know, like that's not right. So she is very suspicious of them too. And we're going to raise a whole generation of robot fighters, and we're probably going to need them too. Yeah. Do we want to do a quick Q&A?
Let's do a quick Q&A.
Hello, everybody.
Shout out to Rob Morris 9, who said, "You guys are my favorite. Thanks for always making my work day better." Aww. Thank you. We're glad that we're able to do that.
It's a great hangout. Thank you, everybody, for joining us.
Yes, indeed. Mark Dell is here, who rightly points out, by the way, that there are specific options, like you said, Devendra, for the wake word for Alexa. They're including computer, Amazon, and Echo.
There you go. That sounds right. Like when it could be anything, even more interesting. Yeah, I don't know. Give it a word where you don't say it on a podcast, you know, and it will trigger your speaker.
Or like make it like a short phrase. That's why the Google Assistant one is, I think, the way that it is, even though it's awkward as hell to say. It's like even with Siri, it's like, hey, you know, and then nobody gonna say hey whatever all the time. I have to not say Siri anymore nowadays because I actually have Apple products now.
I remember you guys calling up my question for Michio Kaku a while back, so we've got people going back for a while, but I'm sorry for interrupting, Dev. What were you gonna say?
We'll see.
For a little while, people were talking about like the possible, you know, we were talking about robots in general. And I mean, it seems like everyone is thankfully has a healthy skepticism of this Amazon bot. You know, we didn't mention it before, but we've mentioned it in the past. Yes, iRobot was mapping the interiors of people's homes for a while, and then they decided to stop doing that. And
it wasn't like full mapping is the thing too. Like because I covered those things, they had a very basic camera to like know the layout of your floor so that the Roomba works better. But it wasn't like they knew like the exact.
What most robots that do that.
They were around one of the first, so they got a lot of flack for that. They weren't clear about where the data was going, like from those room maps, basically. And then actually shortly after that, iRobot sold off their military division. So like anybody saying like, okay, this could be used for weapons, you can't even argue that with that company anymore. But yeah, they haven't really done much since then. Just better Roombas.
The idea is just that they could possibly upload that data to something else and then have a kind of general idea of like, okay, here's your, like your couch is here. And these are places where maybe you could hide.
But, it'll know where to find you. Your Roomba will know
exactly.
Yeah.
And so people started talking about the Tesla robot in the chat. And let's be clear about that. The Tesla robot basically does not exist.
It literally does not exist. It was a guy in a suit.
Yes. There were some drawings of it. And then there was someone dancing around in a morph suit that looked kind of similar.
Let's be highly skeptical of anything Tesla or
anything Elon Musk
announces. It's great that SpaceX is getting people into space and is lifting out, lifting rockets and whatnot. But the whole self-driving thing and the full self-driving thing and that whole thing is so infuriating to me because it's like, this is a very crucial feature, people. And if you get it wrong or if you mislabel it, people will die. And it kind of will set back the whole vision of self-driving too, if you're lying essentially about what you can actually do. So anyway.
Yeah,
that's Elon. So,
shout out to Jesse K, who's working and listening to us. Thank you.
I used
like,
to when
we're
I was
good
in
background
IT.
Sound.
Podcasts are always good background sound. When I was in IT, like there was an era when Dell's motherboards were just like crapping out. So I have personally replaced like over 500 Dell motherboards on desktops because they bought these crappy capacitors. So I'd sit there and listen to This Week in Tech and all of like the big podcasts at the time. So. Podcasts are great, especially when you're doing grunt work.
Okay, and so Mark Dell brings up a very interesting possibility, which is, how would the Amazon robot play? You know, how would the Amazon robot interact with any of my household pets? Mm-hmm. And if dogs are especially scared of vacuums, what would dogs? How would dogs? React to this. I think
poorly.
Basically every household animal would be terrified of this. If you have a free roaming house bunny, your house bunny's going to be freaked out by this robot just roaming around.
Indeed. And if you have any free roaming animals, something that moves with tires, that's you're asking for poop. You're asking for poop to be smeared all over your house.
Oh, that's absolutely true.
Not great. I can imagine just cats are simple. You just put like a laser pointer on one of these things, like tie it to it and let it move around. And especially if it's like a self-moving laser pointer thing too, like that would be pretty easy to rig up. It would be nice to do that. People are buying like pet cameras. So if you're the sort of person where it's like you want to keep an eye on your dog or your cat while you're away, I could see something like this being useful. I have cameras inside of my home just for certain security levels and whatnot, but nothing moving around. But I could see the value in something like this. I do not trust Amazon at this point, folks.
I just wanted to let y'all hear what a Siri in Cantonese sounds like, actually, because she is hella sassy. And also the wake word for Siri when you switch the language over to Cantonese is actually quite funny. So like, it's hey Siri in English. You turn it Cantonese, it's why Siri, which is like ridiculous. But anyway, let me just see. You got gay theme. Oh, it's just showing me the time. Hang on. How do I? Oh, because I'm in silent mode. Okay, hang on. You got gay theme.
而家系上午10:39.
你而家做紧咩？
今日系作家张爱玲嘅生日，我喺度欣赏紧佢嘅名著。从佢嘅字里行间，可以睇到上海同香港里面光怪陆离嘅城市爱情故事。
So I asked, the first thing I asked was what time was it, and the second thing I asked was, what are you doing now? And Siri in Cantonese replied, today is Eileen Chong's birthday. I am a big fan. And then, like, it explains, like, what you can see on the... It just, like, tells me random things about a love story between the city and... So, I don't know. It's getting really philosophical up in here. I'm like, okay. It's all in, like, Cantonese, so I can't really read all of it. So anyway, I'm going to switch this right back to English because it's so that's just easier for me. There we go. I can't pull out the sassy right now. I wish I could, but
are you better at Cantonese or Mandarin?
I'm better at Mandarin just because that's what I know how to speak. Well, grew up speaking like when I was a baby. Cantonese, I only like started speaking when I was like in my teens. All right.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So, I think we can move on. Yeah, I think we're about ready to move on. So everybody, if you have any other questions or something, we'll probably do another little Q&A talking directly to the chat, but we're going to get into other news. We're going to talk about what we're working on. We're going to talk about like some fun pop culture stuff. So
all the fun
stuff. Let's get into that.
Okay. And I'll go straight to the Google stuff for you, Shalyn.
Cool.
Let's move on to some other news, and it is also a Google-filled week, maybe not as much as Amazon and some of the other companies, but what is up with Google, Sherlyn? Like, there's a lot of map stuff and search stuff happening. Yeah.
Hells yeah. This week, Google also had a small event, not really one of those big ones that everybody gets real hype about, but it's so far annual Search On event starting since last year, where it typically unveils new stuff coming to search. And maps, actually. So, but one of the biggest things that was sort of announced in the middle of this event is that Google is adding the Lens feature to desktop Chrome. Lens, by the way, is the feature where you can like look up a photo and like see what's inside the picture and then like pull out details from it. Like a shirt that you saw on someone, you can lens it up and you can like look for it, or you can look up a landmark. But the other thing that Google introduced with Lens is that you can now add a text parameter to your Lens searches. So for example, if I saw your headphones, or your glasses, for example, Devendra, and I took a photo and I was like, okay, what brand is it? And then I can add a text search and say, well, this, but, in sunglasses, or this, but whatever, like you can say the example they gave was better where like they saw a print on someone's shirt and took a photo of it and then looked it up, but then said this but socks or this but a blanket, you know, that sort of thing. And then you can also do that with like vehicle parts. So they had a bicycle on demo and they, you know, took a picture of a, I'm going to butcher the pronunciation of this, but like a derailleur, something like that. It's like a gear, like a wheel part or something. And,
a derailleur? Yeah.
Yes, thank you. They said derailleur. And then one of our team members said it was the wrong pronunciation. So I was like, all right, great. You can look at the, so you can use Lens to look up a part name, but you can also then search how to fix this part. So you don't have to like go through the hassle of going to start another search and being like, how to fix derailleurs and then figure out how to spell it even. So that's a nice, I think, Lens update, and it definitely is helping
you
make better searches. Like if you need more context to a search, right, you have the room for it now. The other things that Google introduced were a new wildfire tracking feature in Maps, which is Carissa on our team said it's sad that this is a feature now. Like
we need it.
The situation is so bad. yeah. That you need it now. That's how bad it is. But there you go. Google also wanted to help you understand the sources of information you're looking at. So it's expanding its existing about this result feature. And it'll show you more context and more information around sources, but also if you want to learn more about a new topic, for example, you can, they have like ways for you. So when you start a new topic, let's say knitting, you can expand out, you can first know the basics and then you can expand out, with, broaden the search or narrow the search, that sort of thing. And then you get all sorts of other related information and all that fun stuff, I guess. And then finally, the thing that interested me the most is the Address Maker app that Google made to basically help government and, you know, nonprofits mass generate these plus codes.
I thought you said Dressmaker app, which I was like, why is Google getting into fashion?
I know. I heard you laugh a little bit. I was like, wait, why? But no. If they made Dressmaker apps, I'd be like, hells yeah. But no, this is Address Maker.
Address,
however you guys say it. Yeah, Address Maker. So plus codes actually have been around since 2015. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. they're a set of like between 6 and 8 or something numbers and characters and letters. So something like a PJ25 plus 2 something, right? Like that sort of thing, mm-hmm. like a postal code. But it ties to like a set of let and long coordinates so that you can basically add a plus code to any area, right? You know how zip mm-hmm. codes and postal codes work? Your postal system has to recognize mm-hmm. it. And not every country, not every region in the world has a sophisticated system. And it sucks when you don't have an address, you can't get deliveries, you can't apply for a job, you can't vote, you can't sign up for a lot of things. So with a plus code, you know, the idea is that you should be able to. It's an mm-hmm. open source and free system. But, you know, it's been in the past really hard to assign these at scale. If you're in a government, you know, you want to help your country or your area or your local neighborhood get addresses, mm-hmm. plus mm-hmm. codes can help. And now it used to take, years? And now it just takes weeks with address maker.
That's really cool. That's actually something that could help a lot of people. I mean, it helps Google too, yes. because it gives like more data to like tie people to. But hey, I'm from a small country in South America. And like last time I had to go visit family, right? It is a 3-hour drive into the middle of nowhere. Nobody has addresses. Like it is,
right.
It is rough. So I could see something like this being super useful. Yeah.
Yes, the example they talked about at their event was how like out in a very like far-flung place, someone was like, mm-hmm. "Oh, we give directions here by saying, you know, that big rock, turn right and then go for like I guess this many miles and like and then make a left at the tree." It's like mm-hmm. If you have a plus code, Google Maps will read them. So yes, for sure, this is a way to get more people on Google Maps, mm-hmm. but also. It's not just for people who are in rural areas. If you've like, in my past job, I had to like make sure deliveries got to the right like factory in China, and like, I'm sorry, but industrial gardens and industrial parks in different parts of the world have very very bad like address systems. I don't even number 2 Xinyi District Block 482, and then like a set of numbers next to each other, and then a road name. Right. And I'm just like, what is going on here? Even for people who live in cities who with established systems can benefit, I think, in general mm-hmm. from this system, where if like we had a unified address system all around the world, like I don't understand London's SQ1 SW2 thing. Like it's just internet.
I don't understand addresses in a lot of places, like people in New York, like just reading Queens addresses trip me up all the time, because they're like number dash something on number street and it's really, if you get one of those things wrong, it sends you to a whole different corner of Queens. So
my favorite is how I always take a risk when I'm going to our video producer Brian O's place, because he lives on, let's say, Smith Avenue. For some reason in my head I always put Smith Place, so I'm just like,
You're just bad at this. I think that's it.
I am. This is gonna help people like me. If you just need to remember a few, like, just need to scan a code, that will work. Yeah. Anyway, that I thought stood out as like a truly potentially helpful feature for people who need it. That was basically it that Google announced at their event. Mm-hmm. Not the biggest, not the flashiest, but
there's actually one thing worth mentioning here too, because after Amazon's event, Google's like, everyone's like, so Google, where are your video? Like another video doorbell, because Amazon just announced like a $50. They announced a $50 one. They announced like cheaper hardware all around and cheaper thermostat. Yep. So Google published a blog post and was like, hey, guys, don't worry. We have another Nest doorbell coming next year. Wired one, a new wired one that's going to support 24/7 video recording. So that's something, but it also shows like, man, you would think a big company like Google would be able to like prep and respond and like assume Amazon is going to start talking about this stuff and you should probably be ready to like respond somehow. It looks like a blog post they wrote during lunch. They're like, I don't know. New one coming next year, guys. Don't worry about it. Just sit tight. It's so desperate. I mean,
I think it's, I read the same blog post as Rishi Chandra, the head of Nest, and he's a really, actually, like, I've interviewed him a couple times. Sure. He's a nice person, seems like, anyway, right to me. And I could see, like, I like that they're pretty transparent about it. At least they didn't have to say it. They didn't have to come out and say it. They actually, they're in that post to acknowledge that they've made some people pretty frustrated with their move to the home app and all that stuff. And to be fair, I think this was also in part in response to the slate of new Nest products they announced in August, which were like, battery-powered video doorbell, which is
everything.
Cool, but
let me just say, everything they're doing is years late compared to Arlo, compared to Ring. And I think that is the, it's just like a constant like comedy of errors. Like, oh no, oh my God. They did it again. Amazon's way ahead of us, so we gotta like we gotta tell people we have this coming.
I think Amazon borrowed this floodlight idea from them, though. I'm not sure if who came first.
Well, I think Arlo came first. So Arlo, formerly part of Netgear, I am on the Arlo camera system.
Arlo's
because typically
pretty good,
their stuff is really good. Google also says, "Hey folks, don't worry, you're gonna have a web interface for the Google Home app to manage your web, like your live streaming cameras on the web next year." Next year.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, Google.
Ring and Arlo have had. Okay. Oh, no. Oh, no. A very basic feature. The most basic feature in the world that Ring and Arlo have had for years.
Yeah.
So when I say I don't trust Google and the smart home folks, it's stuff like this. It's just like, I don't know what's happening on your end.
Yeah.
I do have, I have the most basic Nest thermostat, and even that has been like kind of a nightmare at times. Aww. So yeah, these companies, smart home stuff is very annoying and very weird. Don't get locked into one company, folks. Cause like, yeah, you're going to be beholden to them forever. Let's move on to some news. Yeah. And you may own them. Let's move on to some news from Facebook, which dropped last night, actually. And after we had started planning this episode, but it's worth mentioning, Carissa Bell at Engadget writes about Facebook publishing slides on how Instagram affects teen mental health. This is like some of the source material that the Wall Street Journal posts that we were talking about last week or the week before. This is some of that information getting out there. But Facebook couldn't just release that. They had to like annotate the slide. So you have the slide on one side and like this pile of Facebook notes being like, no, the research is not saying what we're saying. Like, don't worry about it. Don't read too much into this, which is, it is kind of funny because it's sort of like Facebook saying, our actual research scientists who are paid to do this, don't actually listen to them. They're a little wrong. They're kind of like, basically dissing their own researchers for doing their jobs. It is very weird because that's what Facebook does. It's just hilarious. And so far, by the way, like the controversy around all this and the WSJ reports has pushed the company to pause their proposed Instagram for kids. Thank God. Facebook is scheduled to testify later today at a Senate hearing about all these reports. So we'll be interested to see like what happens there. There's a lot. Have you seen the stuff, Sherlyn?
What stuff? Specifically the slides? Or
yeah, the slides or any of this?
I haven't looked at the slides, but I will say I have thought long and hard about how Instagram affects our mental health, not just teens, everyone. And I mean, this has been a long debated topic. I think everyone is on some level aware that it's not very healthy to be like, you know, coveting what people have on social media or comparing yourselves. Everyone knows. And there's been movements, multiple movements. Instagram, I think, like led first on Instagram by influencers going like, oh, you know, Instagram versus reality is a subreddit that I follow. And it's like what people look like on Instagram versus what they look like in real life is just so different and drastic. This account that I follow, I can't remember her full name offhand, but you know, a swole woman who recently got laid off at, I think, Vice. I'm very bad at names, and I apologize for that. But a swole woman, this person...
You're just going to call her,
I'm sorry. Yeah, I just called by her like handle. It's so catchy. It's great. It's a swole woman. I love it. Anyway, she published a lengthy article. I think it was on Substack.
I think Casey Johnson advice, right?
Thank you, Casey. Yes, thank you. She published on, on her own channel or medium that like Instagram is just like an app to to make people feel bad about themselves. And then their algorithm just keeps reiterating that, because like, it's the way, I mean, like, I honestly almost look, if you look at it agnostically without thinking of like the effect it's having on people, the search algorithm works the way it's meant to, right? If you look for something, it'll keep humbling you with related results. So if you looked up candles, you keep getting candles and candle holders and whatnot. But then what happens is that, and this is how it affects diet culture, is that like the second you look for like one healthy eating tip, or you just look at one, or you engage with one, you just keep getting these pictures of super fit people, or like, you know, and then it keeps reminding you that something is off with you, so that you have to buy this product or buy into a lifestyle.
It reinforces this thing. Yeah. What's funny is that it's not like Facebook started out, like the goal wasn't to make people feel bad about themselves, right? The goal was to make people want to keep coming back to Instagram.
Right.
And by pursuing that goal and not thinking about the like unintended consequences, this is kind of where we're at. There's one thing I want to read because it's an annotation I saw on several slides. So like one slide says 1 in 5 teens say that Instagram makes them feel worse about themselves, with UK girls saying it's the most negatives. The annotation is, this research was not intended to and does not evaluate causal claims between Instagram and health or well-being. And they just repeat that over and over again, even though that is the entire point of the research, like, is to see it's how, like, it's actually affecting people.
Nah, not my fault. That's not
it's so... I am more and more angry about Facebook, and every time we talk about it and like their impact on the world and their inability to like handle it is incredibly, incredibly annoying. Anyway, so the Wall Street Journal has released more slides from the whistleblower. So there is actually like a straight up whistleblower within Facebook who's been pushing the stuff out. I believe Congress is also trying to get in touch with that person, like to actually see more of what's happening here. Yeah.
Is this the one where they had like thousands of pages of like of things to share? Because I remember seeing something on Twitter fairly recently about that, but I didn't click through because my brain was burned. But no, yeah, there's been a lot of coverage. I will say though, Facebook, look, instead of saying no causal effect, don't blame us, instead of saying that, you can admit that like it might not be us, but things are starting to show people seem to think that this is having an effect.
Yeah.
Why don't we look into it? Why don't we like fess up? Why don't we just say like, hey, even if it's not our fault, like our intended result, maybe there is something we're doing here that's a byproduct, and we should look to mitigate that. We should try
About results and action, right? So it's like, I don't care if you didn't intend to do this, but you have built this monster of a system that is doing this. So acknowledge it so we can move forward. Otherwise we will never kind of move forward as a society. One thing I want to add here, our podcast producer Ben is noting like these annotations seem similar to like how oil companies talked about climate change. I was reminded of like how cigarette companies talked about like the effects of tobacco, you know,
plastics companies telling you to go recycle. Come on.
Well, that is something people still have to learn, because that was so insidious. Like that was actually a true genius move where they were like, people will just stop talking about this. Let's just give them, let's put the onus on them. Let's put the onus on the consumer so that they feel bad about buying plastic, so that they do this work to handle plastic. And then the big petroleum companies can kind of keep doing whatever they want. So that's going to be a whole other discussion, folks. And I am I'm also very angry about that, too. So
yes,
a lot to be angry about in this world. But let's move on to less contentious news. Valentina, you want to bring up Valentina's Fitbit Charge 5 review, Sherlyn? Like any big takeaways from that?
So we talked with Valentina, I believe it was last week or the week before. And yes, so she had been working on Charge 5 review. The funny thing is just that like we had to wait for some features to come live before we wanted to publish this too. And basically from what I can tell, it's largely the same, just a slightly new look, and that screen is bigger. So if you've been looking for a basic fitness band and, you know, with a larger screen,
It has GPS, which is nice.
On board. Yep, exactly. Since the Charge 4, Charge 4 is when it really got the GPS boost, but then this one has the GPS and the screen. It's starting to look a little Gear Fit-like, though, in my in my opinion, which is, if y'all recall, Samsung's like curved screen fitness band from a while ago. So, you know, that RIP to that, I guess.
Yeah. RIP to that. Remember the whole fitness band craze in the early 2010s and everybody was trying to jump on it. But all of us in Valentina were like, the jawbone up. I do miss the Jawbone app. That was that was a cool thing that often didn't work and basically killed that company. But it was fun while it lasted. Let's round up. Let's kind of turn things down here with a fun story. guess who is Mario? Or Mario.
Who's
Mario? Yeah.
It's me.
I also keep saying Mario because I grew up saying Mario, and then all of a sudden in 64 era, the official pronunciation became Mario. So now that's all an entire generation has grown up with. There was life before that, folks. Who do you think it is, Shrilin? Who would you like to see play Mario?
I know. Who would I like to see? Someone who, what's that word? Not accurately. Someone who authentically represents the character. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Danny DeVito? Yeah.
Sure, yeah.
That would be actually my dream, like, indie drama version of the Mario Brothers movie would be Danny DeVito and, like, John Turturro as Luigi.
That's pretty cool.
And it would be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Chris Pratt is Mario. The worst Chris. Chris Pratt, Star-Lord himself. And it was really funny to see the internet just kind of, like, it was a Nintendo Direct where this announcement happened. Shigeru Miyamoto popped up. We're like, oh, Miyamoto's here. Something big is happening. And then we were all waiting, like, new game, new Mario RPG or something. He's like, no, there's a movie happening. And it stars Chris Pratt. And it's sort of like you could feel a disturbance in the Geek Force. Like, everyone's like, oh, man. Oh, no.
Aww.
And no offense to Chris Pratt, but it's just a lot of things.
Like, I think he's fine.
He's fine, but he's a little overplayed. And I think it's only like...
Kind of like how I feel about Awkwafina. Yeah.
His only good role, though, like, Awkwafina is a good actor. She can do many things. He can do kind of like one thing, and his good thing is Star-Lord. Like, Guardians, his like vibe, his comedic sensibilities was perfect. And then he was in a lot of bad action movies.
Jurassic
so it's like
Park.
The Jurassic World, the first one, awful. Just god awful. and he didn't have much to work with, but he was not great in it. He was in The Tomorrow War, which, again, I think was not a great movie.
I liked it.
People had a lot of things to say about Chris Pratt, but what's funny is that the rest of the cast in this movie is actually pretty good. Anya Taylor-Joy, who I love, she is Peach. Charlie Day from It's Always Sunny is Luigi, which we're gonna get some like nice chaotic Luigi energy there.
It's gonna be amazing.
That's gonna be fun. Jack Black is Bowser, Keegan-Michael Key is Toad, Seth Rogen is Donkey Kong, Fred Armisen is Cranky Kong, which in the mythology of Donkey Kongs is the original Kong. He's the one from the original game, so it's kind of funny. There's gonna be a cameo from Charles Martinet, the video game voice of Mario, the It's a Me voice. So I actually don't hate the rest of this cast. I think this could be really cool. It sounds like this is gonna be an all CG movie. They're aiming for
their voice.
Yep. These are all just going to be voices. They're aiming for a 2022 holiday release, December 21st in the U.S. Or North America specifically. I actually don't hate this. I would actually like to see what this cast does, but I am not looking forward to seeing Chris Pratt as Mario. That's just me. But you could
choose to know. It's voice only, I guess. I mean, you know.
It's voice only. He's very good with voice. I think the Lego movie, he stars in the Lego movie. He's very good there. Like, he's a funny, you know, he's a funny guy. It's just it is funny how quickly the internet turned on him when somebody was like, choose the bet, you know, you have to lose one Chris, and everybody was immediately
I remember that. And then like
Chris Pratt.
Mark Ruffalo had to defend him or something.
Now then he felt bad, like, so either he publicly said something and then the rest of the MCU cast was like, no, he's not the worst Chris, which I don't know. It was very funny, very hilarious. I'm not like dissing him personally. It's just not my favorite Chris, but he will be Mario. It's coming out next year, so we're looking forward to that. Let's move on to what we've been working on, and I want to shout out a couple of things. I spent it's kind of like your iPhone week, Shrilin. Like, I am juggling like three separate reviews right now. I just published my review of the Sonos Beam Gen 2 this morning, so you can read that on Engadget. It is basically the same as the original Beam, but it has like Dolby Atmos processing, which is weird to me because it actually has the same exact speaker drivers as the first Beam. So they basically are using a more powerful CPU to kind of direct where some of that sound is going. And it doesn't have upward firing speakers like most Atmos soundbars do. So you don't get like that sound that bounces off your ceiling and feels like it's filling up your room. You don't get that, but you actually do get some like sort of cool height features too. So if you have a small room and you just want to like upgrade your sound real quick, it's going to be a good option. I really okay. dug it. It sounds pretty good, but $450, which is definitely on the high end for like small compact soundbars. You could get Vizios for like 200 and under. That will sound pretty good too. Okay. And yeah, the big takeaway is like, if you're in that price range and you want like real Atmos sound, there are Vizio systems that cost like $500 that will give you a nice big soundbar, a subwoofer that's wireless, and two like rear speakers that are wireless. So there are a lot of options in that price range. I just think some people just want one box that doesn't take up too much room. They don't want to have rear speakers. So for them, this is going to be a pretty good speaker.
Cool.
I know you're thinking about it, Sherlyn. So if you're thinking about like... This is actually a pretty good one, but I don't know the amount of space you're working with, and I don't know if you like you even need all of this. So, you know, we'll see. We'll talk about it. Next week is the launch of Windows 11. So I am in the midst of reviewing that somehow. Maybe we'll hear more about like other devices running Windows 11 next week. I do not foresee this being as like big as my Windows 10 review, because I reviewed that like when that thing launched, and that was like it took a while. Like I spent weeks writing that review. This one, it feels like more of a service pack, almost like a slight tweak. Yeah.
Even if it seems so much different.
Other than the interface changes, like that's it. It's a slight difference, but beyond that, like it still looks and functions. It still functions just like Windows 10. So that is kind of like what I am wrestling with right now. But keep an eye out for that next week. Sherlyn, what are you working on?
I there's too much stuff I can't say, but people know there's things going on next week, and I'm pre-writing pretty much everything, right? Like there's iOS 15 that I'm still waiting on some features to drop before we publish our review, because I think one of the greatest things about iOS 15 would be SharePlay via FaceTime. So we're waiting for that to be available and stable before we publish our review. And then there's a bunch of events next week that I'm not entirely sure I can talk about. So there's that. So look out next week, is what I'm going to say.
Cool. Very cool. And yeah, let's move on to our pop culture picks. I'm really interested in what you've picked this week.
So this week, Devendra, you're gonna love and hate both of the things that I talk about.
I'm ready. I'm fully ready. Yeah.
Yes. So I had to dig into my archives for this first one. I haven't seen a lot recently. I've just been like binge watching old stuff. And so a while back, maybe a few weeks or 2 months ago, I saw Sorry to Bother You. Have you seen this one, Devendra?
Yeah,
do you love it?
It's fantastic.
It's pretty awesome. So I think if you haven't seen it, Sorry to Bother You is a really great, strange science fiction film that ends really wild. It goes pretty crazy.
I wouldn't even say science fiction. Like nobody knew that's where that movie would be going. It just
I know, but a fun comedy.
Yeah.
I know, but I mean, there's parts of it that were like the way his job is sort of portrayed as like jumping into people's houses. He's a telemarketer. And but that part of it was a little sci-fi. It's not that, like, it's just a portrayal of what he does, right? A call can be as intrusive as just popping into someone's house and sorry to bother you. But I only got hooked into it because like it had the potential of being science fiction-y too. I mean, but it is really freaking fun. I enjoyed the storytelling of it.
That was a fun movie to see in theaters. Like once things go where they go, that was, everybody was bawling over that. Yeah.
It's on Hulu. That's where I watched it. The other thing this second one that I'm going to talk about is not so much a recommendation as it is just a fun brainless thing to do if you have time on your hands and are feeling nostalgic. Devendra, I saw Mars Attack over the weekend again.
Hey, I wouldn't say brainless. Mars Attacks. That's a fun movie.
It's very fun. It's very camp. It's kind of ridiculous. I last saw it when I was a child, and I was like, wait, this movie is pretty crap. Like, it's Tim Burton. It's very, like, it's got a style to it, and it's ridiculous. I, when I say bad, too, I partly mean the special effects are pretty bad.
They're, I think, purposefully cheesy. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, I have no clue for the, like, when I watched it as a kid, I was like, this is great. And there's scene, there's, and the mm-hmm. cast list is amazing. There's, like, Michael J. Fox, I believe, Sarah Jessica Parker, Pierce Brosnan looking fine as hell.
Everyone's in it. Jack Nicholson's in that. Like, everyone's in that movie, yeah.
Every freaking one is in it. So, anyhow, Mars Attacks is a good, like, throwback film if you're feeling a little nostalgic this weekend. Okay, but I
nostalgic saw for 1999? Yeah.
Come on.
It's been 20 years, man. Yeah.
It's been so long. I was alive then. Can you imagine that? Anyway, Devinder, there is another one I want to talk about, but I know it's something you sure. are recommending.
Well, let me go straight to that. I've been watching Midnight Mass, the new Mike Flanagan show on Netflix. And hey, I love Mike Flanagan. I'll say this straight up. Like, he is the best horror director working today, because everything he produces, no matter the shows, Haunting of Hill House or Bly Manor, or his movies like Dr. Sleep, which I adore. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm just fully into everything he does. So I love this guy. Midnight Mass is a show about a small community who lives on an island, I think like off the coast of Massachusetts or something. And weird things start happening. They have a new priest, and weird things start happening. And it's very much like a Stephen King novel of like small weird things. And there may be something preying on the animals on the island. And, you know, things start happening. I will not spoil anything, but I love it so much. And
I'm starting to recognize Mike Flanagan's style, which is very much like characters get a lot of like talking space and talking time to really
expose his characters. Yeah.
Right. But also to expose these very like vulnerable moments where you don't necessarily see in real life. So there's a person who just, you know, has come out of prison and is trying to reconnect with the world. He explains how, you know, his world feels. There is, you know, a person who's coming to terms with trying to be sober, coming to terms with trying to like, there's just so many human stories that we don't get to see. There's the girl who like, you know, is in a wheelchair, and then it's like explaining some of that perspective too. And I found that's what really sucked me in. And that's very much Mike Flanagan's style, is these like very deep, like with Haunting of Hill House, he had like the girl who I don't want to spoil it, that the sister the youngest sister she had a big monologue moment too, and it was just beautiful the way like the scenes and are told through the monologues of these characters. Is to me very very Mike Flanagan, actually very recognizable now.
He's a great writer, and unlike other horror folks, like, he builds characters, right? He makes you want to care about these people. So when bad things start happening, you're like, oh no, please not them. Also want to shout out to Zach Gilford, aka Matt Saracen from Friday Night Lights, who immediately when I see him, because he is the first face you see on when the show begins, I really miss him on TV, because he is such a fantastic actor. And he does a great job of always playing actors who or characters who just need a hug, like characters who are like, that's it. He's very good at that. So anyway, check out Midnight Mass. It is very good. Trigger warning for animal violence, because there is some of that. And I know that like affected some people as they were watching it. And it is rough, but there's a lot of dark stuff in this. Yeah.
My trigger warning was how I didn't expect to be going to church in the middle of a show. I was like, I was reading along with the.
I mean, it's called Midnight Mass, so.
I know. I was like, I feel like it's telling mass. You. Okay, like I'm going to mass. Okay, I'm about to get the Eucharist. Okay, all right.
But quite a unique church that one is. So be sure to check that out. One other thing I want to mention: I got to see one of the first screenings of No Time to Die, the latest James Bond movie, which has been delayed for like 2 freaking years. I have been just like so desperate to see this thing. So they did a really cool thing where they basically did critic screenings synchronized across the world at the same time as the London premiere. So I was able to like watch this at the same time as my, you know, podcast co-host in Seattle and my other co-host in Colorado, and they like did the screenings at the exact same time all across them. So that was kind of wild. this movie, I really love the Daniel Craig. I love a couple of them. Like he's had like a messy run as Bond. Mm-hmm. Casino Royale, one of the best action movies of the last 20 years, followed by Quantum of Solace, a horrible movie that was affected by the writer's strike. So it really had no script. And then I loved Skyfall, which was this almost like a gorgeous, like artistic take on Bond. And that was followed up by Spectre, which was kind of trash, and I hate it. This movie is very long. It's nearly 3 hours long. There's a lot of action, but there's also like a lot of melodrama in here, which I don't think a lot of people will expect, but it really worked for me. I love Daniel Craig as this character, and you know, I think it reckons with a lot of like what is not great about James Bond, the franchise, and the character too.
Yep.
And hopefully like it'll be able to evolve even more like in future movies, but this is Daniel Craig's last Bond. I think it's a fitting send-off, and it is definitely worth seeing in theaters if you can do it safely. That's the other thing. Like, it is really hard to like make time for these big theater movies, especially when it's 2 hours and 45 minutes long. Yeah. It's very long. But I think it's really worth it. Shout out to Kari Joji Fukunaga, who, hey, he is one of my favorite directors working today. He's worked on True Detective. He's made some incredible films, and like he just gives a really good perspective and has a great eye when it comes to action and doing this too. So hey, No Time to Die is good. It's probably going to be the most divisive of the Daniel Craig Bonds. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I'm really interested in that conversation too, because some of my critic friends don't like it at all. So it's very like down the middle, but I'm a big fan. So be sure to keep an eye out for it when it's out. And I think you can wrap, Shalyn.
Well, that's it for our episode this week, everyone. Thank you, as always, for listening. Our theme music is by game composer Dale North. Our outro music is by our very own Terrence O'Brien. Our podcast is produced by Ben Elman. You can find Devendra online at
Devendra on Twitter and at the Filmcast podcast at thefilmcast.com.
If you want to send me the funny things that Siri says to you in Cantonese, I'm at Sherlyn Lowe on Twitter. Email us your thoughts at podcast@engadget.com. Leave us a review, please, on iTunes, and subscribe on anything that gets podcasts, including Spotify.
Woo.
All right. Okay. My neighbor has been smoking, and I'm just like, oh.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Smoking what?
Yeah.
I can't smell. I don't really know
just
what it
in general.
Is. BRB.
You can kick on your HVAC, yeah, or whatever you need, yeah.
No, I'm just going to spray some air.
Okay.
BRB. You can cut away from this box.
Let's take some questions.
So, yeah, we've got some, I mean, there were people talking about how many high profile actors there were in Mars Attacks.
So many. It was a big movie.
I saw Wet Hot American Summer only like 4 years ago or something.
Yeah.
And it was just so crazy. Like I saw it in maybe like 2017, 2018 or something like that. And I was like, wow, like that person's in that movie. Wow. That person's in that movie. Like all of the popular comedic actors from the year 2017 were in this movie from 2001.
Yep. Yep. I mean, Bradley Cooper was even in that, before he was big too. And that was the journey for Bradley Cooper as like big handsome leading man from like the best friend in Alias has been kind of a fun one for me to watch. It's funny when we come across movies like that, Ben. Like I love Wet Hot. I feel like Scott Pilgrim versus the World ended up being one of those two where it's like everyone is in that. Everyone who's kind of like huge now, and I love that movie,
including Brie Larson. Like
including Brie Larson.
So weird. Captain America was like the vegan Ubermensch. Yes.
I feel like everybody, the MCU folks like just watch that movie because that movie is perfect and I adore it completely. You want to just hire everybody out of that movie.
There's quite a lot of funny or great comments, by the way, on just general stuff. Number one, Waluigi as Adam Driver.
Waluigi.
Mark Dell said, I want to see John Oliver thirst over Waluigi. And I was like, oh my gosh, that would be amazing. John Oliver, Jonathan Anderson, by the way, hello, welcome back. Dhruv Karmoka also back. Jonathan Anderson asked for amazing macro shots. I got all of them. We'll share them somewhere.
I kind of want to upgrade just for that and the high refresh rate screen. So
for the screen, yes, the macro is fine. It's whatever. And then Chris Angelo Perez said, "Midnight Mass is what I call the snacks I grab out of my fridge late at night."
No, that's what happens to you after those.
Become the Midnight Mass. I become the Midnight Mass.
You cultivate the Midnight Mass.
Yes, yes.
Jesse K says bye. Thanks for letting us be a part of your workday. That was great.
Bye.
Also, speaking of Chris Angelo Perez, he said earlier that he was able. So he's in the Philippines, and he was able to get his first dose of the COVID-19 vaccine.
Hey, congrats!
Like, great, excellent. Kind of embarrassing.
Embarrassing.
The whole world that it has only taken this long.
I wish we could just take those extra doses and give them to people who actually want them. Yeah.
Which is exactly what the World Health Organization has been talking about. Should Americans be getting booster shots when so many people around the world haven't even gotten a first shot?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Jimmy Chung said my Cantonese is very good. Aww. I guess. RBC says, "Ngo hai Hong Kong fan si." So they're a big fan from Hong Kong. Yes. There.
Aww.
Oh, was that just a translation?
Yeah. And also, they said that and then they said it in English. Yes.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Makes sense.
Or to be fair, they said, "I am Ngo hai. I am a big fan, big Hong Kong fan or fan from Hong Kong." Yes. But there we go. I do love getting to flex the language bits of it. There you go.
So you said that that Cantonese Siri sounded sassy. Can you
I just need to explain why that is. My dad was asking silly questions with Siri, and Siri was just
like, "That's it. Siri would have none of it.
What the hell do you think?" Yeah, it's also maybe because Cantonese is an inherently has a lot of room for sass, so it's or whatever, it just has the inflections and the words for it. So I don't know. I can't remember exactly what my dad. I just thought it was hilarious that it was so sassy to my dad. I think my dad speaks better Cantonese than he does Chinese Mandarin. So
I gotta we gotta bring your dad on to the show and see what's going on here.
I think hilarious. That would be Sherlyn's worst nightmare.
Yes, yes, absolutely. My dream is to eventually Sherlyn's dad sounds really cool. I eventually want to hang out with your dad, Sherlyn, and learn all your embarrassing secrets.
Hey, if we're forcing Sherlyn's dad on, then I guess we have to get my dad on because he has worked in local government in my hometown for basically my entire life. He was really proud of how a big new FedEx distribution facility came in on a big service road, and so he had to write a bunch of new laws because he's a city planner. And
that's
so
great.
One of the new things, new laws and new zoning regulations that he wrote for this is that if FedEx wanted to start doing drone delivery, they need to go back to local government and ask for that, because that would be a completely different situation. You know, they might need air clearance rights or something like that.
Also, maybe we don't need that. Yeah.
He was just really jazzed that he thought so far ahead that there's a possibility that somebody could be referencing.
We have to bring your dad on as a source at some point. Ben, when we talk about drone package deliveries, your dad sounds a good person.
It's mostly the same sort of stuff though, because I mean he focuses on ground stuff, so it would be in the same kind of business and light industrial district. It's just whether or not they need to interface with some other governmental organization
in what order a nightmare for
delivery to happen.
That would be I think first of all, everybody wants flying cars and flying taxis and whatnot. Incredibly stupid, incredibly dangerous. But also the idea of package deliveries by drone, within dense populated areas, also seems highly fraught. I don't know how you guys feel about that. In rural areas where it's really tough to get stuff out, kind of makes sense. I don't want more sky traffic people. We are one drone is so loud and so annoying. Imagine if they're like always above you, dropping packages all over.
And then there's people with the PTSD of drones, but I mean, I don't think they're here in this country, or maybe there are, but
there are some. There are some, like, I remember in Prospect Park once, like, I was just, okay, I have a free afternoon, I'm gonna go read a book, and some jerk just brings one drone out. And it's it's like, now I understand why people want to shoot them down. People are asking, Jonathan Anderson asks, have we watched or talked about Squid Game? I have not seen Squid
Game. It's on my list.
Everybody has recommended it.
Like, everyone has recommended it. Highly recommended to me by, like, our producer, Brian, who's Korean and also
combination.
Very judged about Korean things.
Good, good. It's a perfect combination of everything I love, too. Like, Battle Royale-esque story about kids, is it? Or school kids? Like,
no, I don't think it's kids. I just watched the trailer last night, and apparently it was just people who are, like, on the brink of financial ruin, and so they
also describes Battle Royale.
So they,
I love that movie.
Also a lot of Korean films, or shows.
The thing I'm most curious about is how the title makes sense in Korean, because there's something that's lost in translation. Squid Game doesn't really make that much of that much sense in English, but I'm sure that it's
there's titles in English that make very little sense too.
True. I actually made a list of them recently. Just movies that make absolutely no sense and are somehow related to food.
Title-wise.
Milkshake. Brand New Cherry Flavor. Why is that the name of a spooky horror show? And also Licorice Pizza. What the heck is going on guys?
I mean, you know, what's going on? Brand New Cherry Flavor. Pretty fun. I really like it. I think you would like that show, Lynn, so you should check that out.
I might.
There's like a very easy horror show about like people trying to be creative, like directors and filmmakers in Los Angeles. But like the 90s.
Big warning for, is it entaminophobes? People who are afraid of throwing up in public?
There is a, that is one of the grossest shows I've ever seen. So I think you'll really enjoy it, Sherlyn.
I have a lot of shows on my list that I gotta watch, but I'm gonna finish Midnight Mass first, and then maybe Squid Game, and then
Squid Game,
more John Oliver, and then more random binging of random stuff.
And you should like read some books and like get away from screens for a while too. You've been like overloaded with screens.
Omar Carranza says hi from Mexico. Hello.
Hi. Oh man, I think we are going to wrap soon.
Yeah,
I think we're good. Thank you, folks.
Done. So, if anybody has any other questions that they are just coming up with now, maybe send that to our email address. That's podcast at engadget.com. We really like getting emails, especially because it lets people go into a little bit more depth than, you know, you only get like a 200 character limit. But if you have some like nuanced ideas that are maybe like two or three paragraphs, please send those to us.
Shout out time. I wasn't sure if you're done, Ben.
Oh yeah, no, sure. Go ahead.
Shout out to Chicken Dumpling for the best name this time around.
Yeah, seriously.
Today's best name award goes to Chicken Dumpling.
You're just hungry. It is almost lunchtime. I know. Like,
our all-time best name award still, I think, goes to I Can Poop Twice a Day. Yay.
Yes, I haven't seen Poop Twice a Day in a while. But
yeah, we missed them. But yeah, no, shout out to Wilso, Drew, Carmokar, Chris Angelo Perez, Tanmay Shirsath, D-Man, Mark Dell, Jonathan Anderson, if I haven't said already, and more. We're so glad you all are back. You're, you know, familiar names, but also Veru Kusaki, 86, fairly new name. And Charles Potts, and there was a Ryan, there was a Rob Morris early on. I remember
Simon Phillips, Ryan Watson were
Ryan Watson early on.
Hopefully they are still watching. But
thanks everybody. Motoken,
Jiming Chung, and RBC, the Cantonese speakers. There we go.
Motoken also says Squid Game is a kids' game in Korea. So it, of course. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, and like could Squid Game be the translation of Red Light, Green Light? Because like one of the first things that is in the trailer is like a very deadly game of Red Light, Green Light. Maybe.
Yeah, maybe. I'm gonna watch it. Probably see it all by next week. So stay tuned. Okay. We'll be talking about it. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think we're about done. So this stream comes to you via our video team, which is led by Kyle Mock with Julio Barrientos and Luke Brooks, but it's powered by everyone in the chat. Seriously, thanks for coming out. It's always fun to see people who are watching and engaging, because otherwise we just publish this show into the ether and don't really know anything about the people watching or listening. So if you've stuck around this long, you know how important algorithms are to the world. So leave us a review on iTunes. Just say a few nice words and give us that 5 stars, exactly how you would rate an Uber ride, and it would really help us. Thanks, and we'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Bye.